From Network World, we are going to be talking about video security at the London Olympics. There's been a lot of news recently about some security issues that are going on in terms of manpower, and to talk about this, but in terms of kind of the video surveillance stuff that's going to be going on, is Steve Surfaro. He's from Access Communications. Steve, what are you hearing from your side of things about security at the Olympics? Steve, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, now I've got you on. For some reason, I got you on two windows here now.
Yeah, let's just keep going. Great.
All right.
All right. I didn't hear the question, but
talk about the Olympics. What are you hearing in terms of video security and staffing power, things like that?
Probably what's really trending is a couple of days ago, the opening ceremony was cut over 30 minutes because of the sheer volume of people was underestimated by private security. Probably it's a very difficult thing in itself to do any sort of sponsorship at the Olympics because you have just such a massive number of people as well as assets, and whether they be physical assets, targets, individuals, it's really something that has to be coordinated and orchestrated with the utmost delicacy with agencies, police agencies, federal law enforcement, as we were able to do it over here in the U.S. So overseas, what's happening, I believe, just judging from the initial reports here, as well as just doing some research onto the background of what was estimated for the total security budget, that it was severely under budgeted.
So does that mean that that attendees are going to be in any sort of danger or not? I mean, you know, what does that mean if
most likely not. It's but it's very, very difficult to say because the Olympics are the most high-profile event in the world. You have every nation represented, and you have literally an opportunity for any type of terrorism that can occur. So it's a very difficult venue, very difficult event to protect, so there's no way of actually predicting what the outcome is. You know, what I can predict is that it's going to be a very difficult road for physical security and the law enforcement and the government agencies that are in place as they attempt to just have staff and communications between the staff, let alone use technology. I think technology is the easiest thing in this case.
Let's talk about the technology. What kind of gear do you expect them to be implementing there at the Olympics? And maybe what's different this time than maybe even 2 years ago or 4 years ago from the last time that they held an Olympics?
Well, in the case of this particular set of properties, you've got them spread over a number of different locations. There's probably about three major areas physically to protect. So you're able to set up some individual layers leading to these major venues. And so one of the first types of video-based technologies that in particularly London has used in the past is license plate capture and recognition. So any of law enforcement or any agencies will have been pre-registered into a whitelist. So any vehicles that pass within a grid or multiple layers surrounding these venues will either be investigated further or will show up on further recordings. So one of the interesting things about this type of technology, and we actually use it in various cities throughout the United States, and we use it for investigations, ongoing investigations. So a lot of people think that we're just trying to catch scofflaws kind of as represented in the Parking Wars TV show, which is a very cool television show that just pretty much talks about getting folks that owe massive amounts of parking fines to pay. But the reality is that many cities use license plate captures as almost latent vehicle fingerprints. So you can find out where someone under investigation has previous been, where they hang out typically. So if there's a murder investigation happening, you can see what their normal patterns are. And if those types of patterns are unjudged, unusual by federal and local law enforcement and private security, then it's a great opportunity to pursue suspects and be a bit more proactive in this sort of protection scheme. So, yeah, license plate capture and recognition. I expect facial recognition to be used on a limited population basis. You have to set some real expectations as far as that's concerned. There's certain watch lists, so some of these folks will do this manually and utilize a technology that's a bit more mature, that's face location rather than recognition, and then manually go through some of the databases and see if the person has been located within any of the higher threat or higher sensitive areas.
So is that the case kind of like where the cameras are going to capture people at a specific location and then you'll be able to watch the recording afterwards?
Exactly.
Or how close are we to kind of like the real-time stuff that you see maybe in the Hollywood movies or a TV show, things like that?
Yeah, we actually have the technology right now for real-time on what's known as a small population, like 300 to 1,000. But this only serves facilities like casinos for repeat offenders and some of the most highest profile terrorist groups. But it doesn't do that repeatably well either because they're always changing their facial characteristics or covering their faces. The nice thing about the checkpoints that they're using at the Olympics is that you do have to reveal your face at the checkpoint. So in a small population scenario, it's going to be working very, very well. The problems that are happening at the Olympics right now are one of sheer manpower. So with the given reaction time and the personnel that are over there, it's hard to judge whether there's going to be any issues. What can happen, though, is that there can be an overemphasis on manpower at particular locations instead of being distributed. And one of the worst things that can happen is actual media coverage of the manpower allocation, because this actually gives intel to terrorist organizations.
Right. Let's talk about some of the other improvements that we've seen. Obviously, as cameras get better, you can get things like color footage, and you know, there was a transition from taped-based systems into digital. Talk a little bit about kind of the hardware that you know improvements that you've seen over the year to really help in terms of video surveillance.
Yeah, they fall into two categories. So, and it's really interesting. At some of my security sessions, I ask people, in the event of a crisis, what would you rather do? Would you rather be proactive and prepared, spend most of your money on drills and improving your reaction time to something that has already happened, or would you like to be able to almost predict or take proactive steps? If you had to do your funding one way, what would you do? And a lot of folks make the mistake of saying that they would like to be proactive. And it's kind of a junior mistake, and fortunately one that the Olympic Security Committee is not making. They have a very balanced approach. So what happens is that in terms of technology, video surveillance offers both. They have the proactive, so they have the abnormal detection, which essentially means the video analytics run over a period of time, and then if something unusual is happening, if a vehicle of a different size, or if it's overweighted, if it's traveling low to the ground, or if it's traveling too slowly, or in an erratic pattern, or if it stopped at a particular location, or if somebody places a foreign object, or changes the scene somehow in a public facility, then you might get a video alert that offers an opportunity to be investigated. On the reactive side, we've done some really, really great mature breakthroughs now. And some of them are called summarization or synopsis. So these are, in effect, in the Olympics, or they're essentially quick reviews of what is happening. So, you know, someone at a centralized command center will issue an order and say, please review this video, or please review this stretch of time, and a interval of time of about 12 minutes can actually now be reviewed in about 20 seconds. So it's greatly reducing the reaction time. Now the real benefit are that the cameras are now having embedded analytics, so they're becoming more of sensors, so it's a lower cost for them to be distributed out in various strategic locations without necessarily having directly connected wired infrastructure or auxiliary infrastructure that would be needed to actually perform the analysis, where the analysis is performed right in the camera for license plate capture and recognition and other advanced motion detection. So
we're seeing kind of like smart cameras that can do all that stuff without having to go back to a central server or back to the computers running the software?
Yeah, that's it. They can actually have a notification location that they have to report to. So that will be distributed. That is actually pretty much, I don't like to reveal this, but unfortunately you asked the question. So unfortunately the Olympics are structured where they do have a centralized reporting out, and what I would have done is actually have more of a distributed reporting method directly from the endpoints.
Now we're also talking about kind of some improvements in smartphones and tablets. Now they're being integrated into security cameras as well. Can you talk a little bit about kind of the app world?
Yeah, what's nice about this is that industry has started to really realize, number one, you need dedicated spectrum in order to have video. We just recognize this ourselves, right? So the other thing is you have to take advantage of some of the richer interfaces, and the source of the video itself has to be very resilient. So a lot of this points to the cloud, you know. So, and what's happening over in the Olympics is a sort of private cloud that's used for security and distributing the video-based intelligence and the various sensors that are used, whether they're screening sensors or other types of sensors that are used to detect some abnormalities at the perimeters. So mobile devices are obviously very rich. People are, law enforcement professionals are using a combination of bring your own plus ruggedized, purpose-built laptop computers. I have to hesitate by naming the brand that they use, you know, at the mobile devices that are more ruggedized and have a better battery life, or in the case of bring your own, making sure that they don't have any malware on them. And this is actually a really critical point. Anytime you're working with mobile devices, video mobility, you can actually be doing a tremendous disservice to the security community by having some rogue malware on there that actually will record your keystrokes or monitor where the video streams are coming from. This can have an obvious devastating impact on security itself. So that's a caution on the bring-your-own devices, on the ones that are provisioned and are purposed just for the private network that's used in the Olympics. They don't have to worry about that, but they do have to worry about it on, especially with the private organizations that perhaps have a lot of the devices that are receiving intel and giving out intel that haven't gone through such stringent screenings and cleansing of the mobile devices themselves.
Right, so just getting back to the mobile device question for a second, you would expect to see security personnel kind of maybe carrying around a phone or a tablet, being able to monitor the feed from the different cameras that are around?
Yeah, the ones that you'll actually see, you'll pretty rarely see them looking at video on a consumer-type device.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see them monitoring them on small ruggedized PDAs or ruggedized purpose-built tablets. In other words, they'll actually be the size of a larger iPad, but they're droppable, and they contain a tremendously large battery. They can withstand environmental effects, and they're daylight readable. So, yes, definitely expect them to be seeing not necessarily real-time video, but they'll be taking a look at clips. You know, people will be sharing clips. Do you know this person? What does this look like if there's an emergency? In most of the cases, they're actually using it to help the entire process in non-security applications. So if there's a safety emergency or a health emergency, they'll be sending along information on perhaps somebody that is being treated.
Okay, and this is going to be not related to the Olympics, but I just wanted to ask this while we had you on the show here. You always watch a Hollywood movie, and you know you've got like a show like 24 where they're scanning the facial recognition and they can do it immediately. But then you see on the other side, like, you know, maybe someone is robbing a convenience store and there's grainy footage and you can't barely tell. Where does kind of reality sit in between those two extremes these days?
Well, fortunately, reality at a high impact event at the Olympics is much closer to HDTV, what we actually have at home and what we're using in the palm of our hands. They're recording in a much higher resolution. They're not necessarily sharing it. So what unfortunately though happens is the information, the investigations that occur often involve legacy equipment. So you're going to see the full spectrum of evidence, and that's okay. That is actually okay, because every bit of evidence contributes to the hopeful, successful capture of somebody that's planning to do some bad things. So you're going to see the entire spectrum, but as you get closer physically to a high-profile event like that, you're going to see higher and higher quality, video quality that's used for both forensics and real-time monitoring. Here, in corporations and in agencies that are deploying network cameras, the standard is HDTV.
Mm-hmm.
It's the standard is actually HDTV. So you are not necessarily seeing the standard resolution cameras being deployed anymore as a new project. They would have to be an extraordinarily specialized product that has ultra-low light sensitivity, that has to have a smaller imager. But by and far, what is happening is the higher quality HDTV cameras are becoming a standard. But also, improved lighting is a standard. So you're seeing at the Olympics, plus in public safety, and in cities throughout the world, LED lighting is rapidly taking the place of conventional high-intensity lighting that almost has a yellow tinge to it. So LED lighting is so white and provides for a great recording and realization of color fidelity.
All right, so that, does that mean in the future we're going to be seeing better security footage on the news when they're trying to track people?
You know, there's I can't commit to that because we're just tapping into that market now. What's happening is that, for example, Axis Communications has a new network camera product out called Axis Camera Companion, which essentially reduces the price by about 80%. For a convenience store, so that's getting HDTV directly in the hands of the folks that most need it, you know, where a lot of these issues are happening, and that product just came out about 6 months ago, so there's going to be a substantial inertia. However, you're going to see that quickly go away over the next 2 years, because especially in markets that are predicted where video surveillance will have the most growth, like city surveillance, in education areas, and in retail. So it's good news that the solutions are available and that those three markets correspond some of the most forward-reaching markets. And so you're going to get video quality in the hands of the people that need it the most.
Now, as the resolution improves and you start seeing like high-definition cameras all out there, what kind of storage requirements are people going to need? Is it going to be a big jump in storage requirements, or does the fact that a lot of this stuff is going to be embedded into the camera might help reduce either the storage requirements or the network bandwidth between the camera and maybe the central location?
Yeah, the wonderful thing that's happening is that there's a little bit of consumerization going on, so... as you said, the storage embedded in the cameras, a 32 gigabyte SD card can store 2 weeks worth of HDTV video. So it's that's a wonderful thing. If you don't have a camera that has SD card capability, that's okay, because there's products like EMC iOmega's network attached storage device that can be placed close by to the camera. Instead of having to buy another legacy DVR that'll cost you over five or six times as much as a network attached storage device. So the same products that you use to back up your computer and store your media are going to accommodate that storage. So the answer to your original question is, yeah, it's got a bigger footprint. That's improving also. H.264 video compression is continually improving. In fact, over the next year and a half, it's expected to improve by 20%. And then by the time about 4 years comes, we will be ready for another video compression, which will be most likely H.265, or will be called something else. But we've got a lot of wonderful things that are happening with video streams, and we can thank the wonderful video communications market and the content distribution market to allow us to both store and distribute these streams most efficiently.
Okay, one more question, Steve. In terms of, are you seeing the security market embrace the cloud in terms of storage from these cameras, like maybe a really, really remote location can upload their data to the cloud and then others can access it from the cloud? Or is there still a concern about the data on the security that they need private clouds?
Yeah, there's absolutely a concern about security data, but that concern, it amazes me, because the folks that are most concerned about that are actually the folks that are not writing data security policies. It's the network administrators, the folks that actually understand information and data security and geographic distribution and the method of deployment of private clouds, understand cloud. They're embracing it. They are understanding how to move very large pieces of data and to model their future networks to leverage the benefits of having a private, public, or hybrid cloud. So information technology professionals are embracing it. They're at a real land grab, meaning that they're almost at the peak. In fact, federal CIO professionals are understanding it. There was just a NASA even just opened up a massive private cloud. So the IT professionals are embracing it. Unfortunately, the physical security professionals are lagging behind. And what's going to happen is that the physical security professionals that are the most pliable and work with their IT professionals as true counterparts in their security ecosystem are going to be the ones that most succeed. If they do not, what will happen is that certain portions of the folks that supply network infrastructure will begin to supply cloud services, and that will begin to, we will wind up beginning to see more and more of these recurring monthly revenue services move from the security industry over to solution providers and IT professionals that are in the ecosystem of the actual network itself.
All right. Any final thoughts about kind of things that we might not have touched on with the Olympics in general? Anything else that you're hearing or seeing that you wanted to bring up?
Yeah, probably the best thing is, you know, embrace new technologies wherever possible, test them out. Understand that there's a lot of great stuff out there. Don't be afraid to try something new out that's purpose-built for your application. And above all, just to coin a phrase, you know, if you see something, say something. You're the best security network that's around.
All right, Steve Surfaro from Access Communications, thanks a lot for joining us on the show today.
Thank you so much.